I don't think it matters. No? I mean, everything has been done, you know? Everything has been done. So there is nothing new that is happening. For example, I sit and paint that Leonardo angel's face. You know, it takes me a month to do it. And I do it because I love to do it. You know, I want to just feel the way in which, I mean, one can't say that I want to feel the way in which he would have felt. That's too much. But I just want to recreate that. So there are lots of things that I'm recreating. There's lots of, for example, Leger's work. You know, I felt this. And now I want that in my work. So it's been done before. What I bring to it is my sensibility, my work, my surroundings, all that. So it doesn't bother me at all.
I'd like to return to the idea of the outsider. It's extremely intriguing. So what would you understand by being an outsider? Does it have something to do with the mystery of the artist and ambiguity in the way society sees you, because you are connected to society, right? Your works prove it. So what does being an outsider mean to you? In what way do you articulate that?
You know, there are, as a social being, you have to think and behave within certain parameters, you know. Otherwise, you're antagonizing people, crossing paths, not just being a proper social being. Now, being an outsider is the liberty to be outside this, you know. And until and unless a society allows artists that freedom, the society becomes, you know, it doesn't grow. Just as other people, I mean, scientists or whoever, if the society does not allow that space outside. So being an outsider is just that, just being allowed to think forbidden thoughts, you know?
Does it mean freedom of expression?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. And expression in the sense that I know only by saying something. I do not know something beforehand, and then I do not decide whether I should say it or not. I don't know it before I say it. So freedom of expression means freedom of thought as well as expression.
Just hold on a minute. The gentleman has been waiting. Yeah.
I would like to ask you a little bit about what is your relation with what is written about your work? Interpretations or formal writing about your work, how do you react to that, or does it inform your work?
Yeah, firstly, before what is written, I think what friends who come to see the work that I show work to, what they think of the work is very important. And many times, what my wife thinks about it, all these things will definitely affect, and I would think about it, you know. So that is important. What is written, there are people who have written very well, who have given me insights. Ranjit, for example, you know, has written things which brought to my notice things that I would not have. He was prodding me with questions which made me think of things about my own, like, growth that I would not have normally, you know, gone into. So they definitely help. Then there are, of course, many things that are too superficial, they do not touch the core, yeah, that you feel that they don't get the point, all that. But that's part of the... But I take it seriously, whatever is written in that sense, you know? And also, it's always good to have nice things written. So, yeah, and not so good to have bad things written. So, but it makes a difference.
Hey, recently, the Piramal Arts Museum had an exhibition called The Mutable, where I saw one of your works, which was in terracotta. I don't know if you recall the one that I'm referring to, but it was a landscape. It was a very tiny one.
Yeah.
And I fell in love with it the minute I saw it, because I really had to look hard to try to see what you were seeing in there. Now, I'm sorry, I don't have a point of reference for it, so the audience will not know what I'm referring to. but it was literally a landscape in a terracotta tile. Do you think you'd be able to tell us a little bit more about it? Was that the end, or was that the beginning of another piece of work, or was that an experiment?
Just about four works that I did. I did a lot of heads at the same time. This was done around 88 to 90, around that 1988-90. And the terracotta, the relief kind of landscape, when I showed you those two paintings about the boy, naked running out of the lake, and the calf against the kind of uprising hill, they very much relate to that kind of work, where it's an investigation of how low relief resolves the question of space. And Ghiberti's doors, for example, in Florence, are the first example, and Donatello's kind of reliefs, where perspective was firstly addressed. Now, how to suggest a space receding for, say, a furlong within the thickness of less than an inch, you know? So the relief is less than an inch. So what is behind is, and then what is in front. So within this space, how do you, so that is the kind of question that is addressed in those two works, where there is land rising immediately behind the calf, and where the boy is, the landscape is much further up. But I put a brushstroke on the face, and I put a brushstroke on that rock, which is a furlong behind. And then I put a brushstroke on the leg of the calf and on the ground that is next to it, which are just inches apart. How do they differ? How does that space get created? You know? So I was looking at, and I love those reliefs, historically, all those reliefs, and I think they tell me a lot. I would love to, and in fact, do more work, but I haven't got around to it. There was one of those series that was exhibited recently at the Pyramid Museum in the terracotta show.
That's
yes.
Where you saw it.
That's where you shot. Okay. Oh, yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry. But that is one of the first pieces. That was one of your first works that I had seen.
Yes.
And I'm so sorry about this. I'm not really very connected to art, but that was one of the first pieces that I had seen and fallen in love with. So the minute I found out you were coming here, I mean, that was one of the reasons
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry. I thought you mentioned Peabody because I think there are some in Hurwitz's collection there. Yeah. So, yeah.
One. Just hold on.
I think as a realistic painter, I just like you to give advice, if you were to give advice to realistic painters today, as to how they could, you know, hold their own in the contemporary world of art, so to say. What kind of advice would you give them? You know, especially at a time when you're expected to be distinctive in your style, you know, have your own uniqueness to your style. Of course, you've done a great job because despite being realistic, I think your compositional elements, I just love that, the way you play around with, you know, imagery and give a, you know, multiple narrative to the entire painting. But what would you tell realistic painters today? How should they go about their craft in a manner that, you know, they can develop that that edge, that distinctive style while,
and I'm at a loss.
Is it possible? So maybe adopt, you know, clear down the technique, although you're not allowed to, you know, if you're to remain a
I don't think there are any kind of, you know, guidelines like that.
Things.
No, I don't know.
With technique.
Yeah, that's when you need. You're trying to do something and it's not coming right, so you try something else. You know, so
you. Stroke like Van Gogh or something like that.
No. I think you just have to follow your nose and instinct.
Thank you, Sudhir. I think all of us here, whether they're students or whether they're artists, or whether they're collectors or just connoisseurs, they've all had a very enriching experience. And I think you all will agree. You all will give them a massively big hand for that. what we do with this particular series is that it's recorded, and if the artist is agreeable, it's put onto YouTube for the world at large. So the previous ones are already there, because this is not a copyright problem, as all other lectures are. And so you will find Charles Correa giving his last public talk. It was here, and that's on YouTube. There's, of course, Atul, and it's also William Kentridge, there, Anita, and a host of artists who have very kindly come here and shared their works with us. And so Sudhir, if it's okay with you, we're going to put you up on YouTube as well, as soon as we can. We're not very savvy technically. We are getting there. But it takes us, you know, like somebody can do it tomorrow. We could take perhaps 3 days instead of 1 day. But it will happen, and I promise you it will be the unedited version. So exactly what you said and how you said it will be there for the world at large to see. Yes, yes, yes. It's being recorded with the images. And so we hope to see you here again soon. I don't know if we have everybody's email address. If you'd like to be kept informed, as we have much happening here all the time, especially now that we have 8 tracks of courses, different subjects, and a 9th about to begin in April. So if you'd like to be part of us, do put your email IDs there. And we'll see you on the, what do we have next? On the 5th. Yes, of course, Gujarat. Maharajas and Nawabs of Gujarat. And it's incredible the kind of response one gets for a subject like that. But, you know, fascinating, of course. We have to end with a very funny note. We ask everybody to register, because we need to know what numbers we're talking about. So when we register, and of course they put their names down, and they'll say, former of this, of Kathiawar, former Morbi, state of Morbi, state of Jind. I mean, it's incredible how many we've got of that particular kind coming. And we're very excited that they'll all be here. So it's going to be our version of the Imperial Darbar of 1911. And so do come. And then, of course, for the new film, Louis Kahn, which Sundaram has directed, Louis Kahn, and it's the first time it's being shown in India. It's going to be here, so let us know if you're coming. And of course, the rest of it is so much that I don't want to repeat it all over again, just the next two. So thank you so much for coming, and a good night.